Upfront Books presents The Dynamics of Military Revolution, 1300 to 2050, edited by MacGregor Knox and Williamson Murray, and narrated by Victor Vertunni. Chapter 1. Thinking About Revolutions in Warfare, written by Williamson Murray and MacGregor Knox. The term Revolution in Military Affairs, RMA, became decidedly fashionable in the course of the 1990s. It lies at the heart of debates within the Pentagon over future strategy and has gained increasing prominence in Washington's Byzantine budgetary and procurement struggles. Yet few works throw light on the concept's past, help situate it or the phenomena it claims to describe within a sophisticated historical framework, or offer much guidance in understanding the potential magnitude and direction of future changes in warfare. This book is an effort to answer those needs. Conceptual roots. Current notions of revolutions in military affairs derive from two principal sources: early modern historians and Soviet military theorists. The closely related concept of military revolution emerged in 1955 in an inaugural lecture by the British historian Michael Roberts. Roberts argued that in the early 17th century, under the leadership of the warrior king Gustavus Adolphus, Sweden had embarked on a military revolution that had swept away traditional approaches to military organization and tactics throughout the West. That claim provoked several decades of furious debate over the extent and nature of the changes in 16th and 17th century warfare. In the end, most specialists came to agree that Roberts had been correct in suggesting that European warfare in this period had undergone fundamental systemic changes. But until the 1990s, military historians focused on other periods of Western history had largely ignored the concepts developed in the debate that Roberts had opened. The second major influence on the development of the notion of revolutions in military affairs was the writings of Soviet military theorists from the 1960s onward. Marxist-Leninist indoctrination made the Red Army, from its beginnings, receptive to notions of major revolutionary change. Soviet theorists had pioneered in analyzing the overall impact of the First World War on military technique in the 1920s and early 1930s. Stalin's attempts to ensure the security of the rear and his own uncontested domination by massacring his military elite checked the Red Army's development of modern operational theories from 1937 onward. But the catastrophes of 1941, in which the German Blitzkrieg came close to destroying the Soviet Union, offered an unforgettable demonstration of the possibility of revolutionary change in war. Soviet operational art belatedly recovered, and by 1945 had surpassed even the achievements of the Germans. From the late 1940s, Soviet development of missile and nuclear systems likewise came to rival that of the West. Yet the appearance in the 1970s of striking new technologies within the American armed forces, precision-guided munitions, PGMs, cruise missiles, and stealth, suggested to Soviet thinkers that a further technological revolution was taking place that had potentially decisive implications for the Soviet Union. Given their close attention, grounded in ideology, to material factors, the Soviets focused on the technological aspects of what they perceived as an emerging military-technical revolution. Marshal Nikolai V. Ogarkov, chief of the Soviet General Staff from 1977 to 1984, commented that these advances made it possible to sharply increase, by at least an order of magnitude, the destructive potential of conventional weapons, bringing them closer, so to speak, to weapons of mass destruction in terms of effectiveness. From the Soviet perspective, this was a particularly frightening prospect. The new smart high-technology weapons that the American armed forces were developing and deploying threatened the very bases of Soviet operational art and of Soviet strategy. the immense armoured masses deployed in depth and aimed at swiftly submerging NATO's outnumbered defenders. Analysis of the highly effective use the US Air Force had made of laser-guided bombs in the 1972 linebacker air campaigns undoubtedly heightened Soviet unease. That discomfiture could only have grown as Soviet planners absorbed the implications of the wide use of air defense suppression weapons and PGM by the Israeli Air Force in the Yom Kippur War and in subsequent air battles against the Soviet Union's Arab proxies. At the same time, the Soviets were watching US developments, such as the Assault Breaker program, which aimed at developing short-range ballistic missiles armed with clouds of precision submunitions targeted to the full depth of the theater of war against the follow-on echelons of any Red Army drive toward the Channel and the Pyrenees. The ability to threaten and, if opportunity arose, to conquer Western Europe on the ground after 1944-45 had been the basis, even more than the nuclear arsenal acquired from 1949 onward, of Soviet Russia's world position. By the 1970s, that position was in mortal peril. Andrew W. Marshall and his Office of Net Assessment within the Pentagon were the first to register the significance of Soviet writings on military technical revolution. From the mid-1980s through the early 1990s, the commentaries on Soviet doctrine and on the concept of revolutions in military affairs emerging from Net Assessment proved increasingly influential within the U.S. defense community. Marshall and his office emphasized above all the conceptual and doctrinal rather than the purely technological aspects of RMAs. Net Assessment's explicit use of the term revolution in military affairs instead of the Soviet military technical revolution indeed aimed at focusing the attention of the American armed forces on issues far broader than technological change. Marshall also argued repeatedly that the U.S. armed forces had not yet realized a revolution in military affairs, but were in reality no further along than were the British in the mid-1920s when they first began experimenting with armored and mechanized warfare. America's crushing victory in the Second Gulf War raised interest throughout the U.S. armed forces in the revolutionary prospects of current and foreseeable technologies to an almost uncontrollable pitch. But it also had three decidedly negative consequences. First, the mastery seemingly demonstrated in the Gulf revived the very worst feature of U.S. defense culture: the recurring delusion that war can be understood and controlled in the mechanized top-down fashion of Robert Strange McNamara and his entourage in the 1960s. Second, victory provided the services with yet another argument in favor of procurement of new and enormously costly platforms such as the F-22, while unleashing claims from specialized pressure groups such as the InfoWar community. Finally, victory through technology appeared to promise the strategic freedom in the age of the masses, seemingly lost in the paddies and jungles of Vietnam. Virtual war, with minimal bloodshed, could render unnecessary the presidential leadership, military statesmanship, and popular commitment to the fight that was seemingly in such short supply. Advocates of U.S. leadership of a revolution in military affairs outside the Office of Net Assessment made little effort to place this putative future in some sort of historical perspective. Attempts to examine the nature and limits of such revolutions in the past might, to the common sense mind, appear to offer a means of gauging both the possibilities and the pitfalls inherent in radical changes in war. The writings of the enthusiasts have, nevertheless, displayed an outstanding lack of historical consciousness. Patterns and Concepts, Military Revolutions. While Pentagon debates swirled around issues of immediate interest to the services, such as which multi-billion dollar weapons platform might best support the coming revolution in military affairs, historians had nevertheless begun to look beyond the 17th century for examples of revolutionary military change. A paper delivered at the Spring 1991 meeting of the Society of Military History suggested that the history of Western military institutions since the 14th century had involved periods of violent change followed by periods of relative calm in which armies had adapted to major changes in their environment, a pattern which evolutionary biologists have called punctuated equilibrium. Such an approach offers one, admittedly metaphorical, way of understanding revolutionary change in warfare. The difficulties inherent in understanding the pattern of past revolutions arise from the enormous complexities, ambiguities, and uncertainties in the historical record. The two distinct concepts already sketched out best describe radical military innovation. The first and most far-reaching in consequences is the military revolution. Its defining feature is that it fundamentally changes the framework of war. Five military revolutions have had that effect in Western history. 1. The creation in the 17th century of the modern nation-state, which rested on the large-scale organization of disciplined military power. 2. The French Revolution of the late 18th century, which merged mass politics and warfare. 3. The Industrial Revolution of the late 18th century and after, which made it possible to arm, clothe, feed, pay, and move swiftly to battle the resulting masses. 4. The First World War, which combined the legacies of the French and Industrial Revolutions and set the pattern for 20th century war. 5. The advent of nuclear weapons, which, contrary to all precedent, kept the Cold War cold in the decisive European and Northeast Asian theatres. These five upheavals are best understood through a geological metaphor. They were earthquakes. They brought systemic changes in politics and society. They were uncontrollable, unpredictable, and unforeseeable, and their impact continues. The leaders of North Vietnam in their wars against French and Americans drew inspiration from the French Revolution and its Bolshevik and Maoist progeny, as well as from Vietnamese nationalism. Those who expect the Information Revolution, if it is indeed a revolution, to bring radical military change, will consequently find the direction, consequences, and implications of any change that may result to be largely unpredictable. Military revolutions recast society and the state, as well as military organizations. They alter the capacity of states to create and project military power, and their effects are additive. States that have missed the early military revolutions cannot easily leapfrog to success in war by adopting the trappings of Western technology. Oil bought Saddam Hussein fabulous quantities of Soviet, French, and American hardware, but hardware alone could not confer battlefield effectiveness on forces conscripted from a society that possessed neither a modern state nor the solidarity and resilience generated through mass politics, nor the breadth and depth of technological skill common throughout societies that had passed through the Industrial Revolution. Whereas the Vietnamese communist movement, which combined the revolutionary fervor of the French Revolution, derived equally from its French colonial masters and its Muscovite and Chinese patrons, with a bureaucratically organized and profoundly xenophobic traditional culture, defeated one Western great power and one superpower. The first of the five great military revolutions introduced a degree of order and predictability into an activity, war, that since the collapse of Rome had largely been the province of anarchic improvisation. Governments, insofar as the personal entourages of kings and princes merited that name, had, with few exceptions, exercised only the loosest control over armies and fleets. Employers frequently failed to pay their troops. Subsistence through pillage was the usual result. In 1576, the unpaid soldiers of the Spanish monarchy mutinied and sacked the great city of Antwerp, an action that wrecked Spanish policy in the Netherlands and advanced the cause of the rebellious Dutch. The mutiny reflected both the inherent indiscipline of the soldiery and the inability of the financially decrepit Spanish state to compensate them for their sacrifices. Similar episodes recurred throughout the 30 Years' War that devastated Germany and Central Europe from 1618 onward. But other powers tamed disorder. The Swedish Articles of War of the early 17th century made clear that soldiers would dig when they were told to dig, an uncommon notion up to that point. Impersonal military discipline focused upon the state made European military organizations of the mid to late 17th century infinitely more effective on the battlefield than the feudal levies, mercenary companies, and haphazardly organized hostilities-only forces that they replaced. And the new disciplined military instruments were self-reinforcing. They backed with force the state's collection of the taxes needed to pay the troops regularly. In return for pay, the state could and did demand that its soldiers maintain a disciplined obedience in garrison as well as on the battlefield. Western societies could thenceforth take for granted the order and responsiveness of their military institutions. That was indeed a revolution, as the consequences of its absence in Latin America and much of the Third World during the 19th and 20th centuries make clear. The French Revolution further widened and deepened the state's grip upon the wealth and manpower of its citizens. The secular ideology of equality and its correlative nationalism injected into war a ferocity that far outstripped the religious fanaticism of the preceding century. Two immense world conflicts resulted: the French War of 1792 to 1815 and the German War of 1914 to 1945. Faced with a foreign invasion that they had themselves provoked through nationalist lunacy, the leaders of France in 1793 declared a levée en masse that placed the French people and their possessions at the state's disposal for the duration of the war. From this moment, until our enemies have been driven from the territory of the Republic, the entire French nation is permanently called to the colors. The young men will go into battle, married men will forge weapons and transport supplies, women will make tents and uniforms and serve in the hospitals, children will make old cloth into bandages, old men will have themselves carried into public squares to rouse the courage of the warriors and preach hatred of kings and the unity of the Republic. The French thus tripled their army in less than a year, and although the new troops long remained less effective than their opponents on a unit-by-unit basis, they could accept casualties and fight on a scale that no other 18th-century army could match. The Prussian philosopher of war, Karl von Clausewitz, saw the new French armies at first hand and later wrote that, "Suddenly, war again became the business of the people, a people of 30 millions, all of whom consider themselves to be citizens. The people became a participant in war instead of governments and armies as heretofore. The full weight of the nation was thrown into the balance. The resources and efforts now available for use surpassed all conventional limits. Nothing now inhibited the vigor with which war could be waged, and consequently the opponents of France faced the utmost peril." French conquest and tyranny ultimately forced upon the other peoples of Europe a willingness, in the unintentionally ironic words of a 20th century American president, to bear any burden, pay any price. France's adversaries brought France to heel through the same measures, the national mobilization of resources and manpower that had given France its battlefield edge. And the revolutionary example influenced others across time as well as space. The combatants of the American Civil War and of the two world wars replicated with even greater ruthlessness and effectiveness the social and political mobilization that the French revolutionaries had pioneered. Concurrently with the French Revolution, the first stages of the Industrial Revolution were already underway in Britain. That upheaval changed radically the economic underpinnings of British society and placed hitherto unimagined resources in the hands of the nation's leaders. Yet industrial technology offered the armed forces no major battlefield innovations until the mid-19th century. The British Army under Wellington fought in thoroughly traditional fashion. Yet behind the scenes, the Industrial Revolution nevertheless provided the British government with the enormous wealth needed to cobble together and sustain the great coalitions that eventually defeated Napoleon. The alliance of 1813 that brought together Britain, Austria, Russia, and Prussia at last mobilized the continent's resources sufficiently to overwhelm Napoleon's tactical operational genius. Britain's financial power was the decisive force behind that mobilization. The Industrial Revolution first influenced the battlefield in the Crimean War. Rifled muskets, telegraphy, and steamships combined to let Britain and France project forces as far afield as southern Russia, where they ultimately defeated numerically superior Russian forces. But no party to that conflict was willing to mobilize the national passions, manpower, and resources required to fight the war to a finish. It was left to the opposing sides in the American Civil War, South as well as North, to begin the process of combining the ostensible benefits of technology, railroads, steamboats, telegraphs, rifled muskets, breech-loading rifles, and improved artillery, with the French Revolution's mobilization of belief. Between 1861 and 1918, Americans and Europeans then married the two great revolutions at the end of the 18th century, the French and Industrial Revolutions, into an even more terrifying new military revolution. For those who fought the American Civil War, the result was a frighteningly lethal conflict that lasted 4 years and in the end destroyed the antebellum South as a society. The grim bummers of Sherman's army who turned the towns of Georgia and South Carolina into chimneyvilles were the precursors of Bomber Command's dehousing of Hitler's followers. Almost concurrently with the U.S. Civil War, the Europeans fought three major wars in 1859, 1866, and 1870-71 that also pointed the way toward the future, if less conclusively than the conflict across the Atlantic. The last of the three, the Franco-Prussian War, might have turned into a war as all-devouring as the U.S. Civil War, but Napoleon III and his high command displayed such extraordinary ineptitude during the war's opening phases that they destroyed the entire French professional army at Metz and Sedan. Those disasters prevented the French from repeating the levée en masse successfully. The new Third Republic that succeeded Napoleon III lacked the experienced cadres needed to create effective armies from the recruits it called to arms. It was thus not until 1914 that the Europeans experienced in full the ferocity of a war that combined industrial firepower and logistics with the fighting power and staying power that nationalism could generate. The First World War had the most profound impact of all Western military revolutions to date. Politically, the consequences of 1914-18 convulsed Europe until the final collapse in 1991 of the Communist Empire created in 1917-23. Militarily, the Great War was equally revolutionary. The armies that fought it developed the wholly new and three-dimensional forms of combined arms tactics and operations described as the modern style of warfare. The navies likewise explored war in three dimensions and three elements, pioneering submarine warfare, carrier operations, and, despite dramatic failure at Gallipoli, amphibious warfare, and strategic bombing made its first grim appearance. The as yet rudimentary development of the internal combustion engine, a defect remedied in the Great War's even more lethal continuation in 1939-45, still limited the development of these and other military techniques. But the extent of the revolution is clear enough. A British or German battalion commander from summer 1918 could have understood the underlying concepts governing warfare in 1940, 1944, or even 1991. But a 1914 battalion commander, magically transported to the Western Front battlefields of summer 1918, would have had great difficulty in understanding what he saw. The development and use of nuclear weapons in 1941-45 constituted the most recent military revolution. In the ensuing Cold War, the United States and the Soviet Union deployed massive arsenals, incorporating two leading-edge technologies, the American nuclear bomb and the German ballistic missile. The threatened destruction of their opponents and of the rest of humanity many times over. Yet that very destructive power inhibited the two contenders from seeking through the use of force to compel the enemy to do their will. That two heavily armed powers, whose hostility was thrice overdetermined by ideology, geopolitics, and on the Soviet side above all, by the requirements of totalitarian domestic stability, failed to fight the long-anticipated Third World War, was historically wholly without precedent. Only the existence of nuclear weapons and the historical accident that the power that enjoyed a brief but unique monopoly over them was democratic rather than totalitarian explains Europe's post-1945 long peace. The Cold War is over, but nuclear weapons remain. Their future Pacific influence in the hands of rulers less responsible than those of the Cold War era should be a perennial subject of anxious speculation. Revolutions in military affairs. The great military revolutions that have rocked the West and much of the rest of the world since the 17th century offer small comfort to the military professional. Those who passed through the fires of the great wars that rent Europe from the 17th century to the mid-20th, or faced the rigors and anxieties of the nuclear era, came to recognize the grim face of revolutionary change. They could rarely aspire to do more than hang on and adapt. If an information revolution that may parallel in magnitude the advent of the modern state, the mobilization of whole peoples through secular ideology, the mechanization of killing through science and technology, and the ultimate terror of thermonuclear annihilation is indeed in the process of enveloping the world, then the resulting uncontrollable onrush of events will sweep nations and military organizations before it. The record of the past, nevertheless, suggests the existence, alongside and within the military revolutions, of clusters of less all-embracing changes. These lesser transformations are best conceptualized as the revolutions in military affairs already described. They do appear susceptible to human direction, and in fostering them, military institutions that are intellectually alert can gain significant advantage. Military organizations embark upon an RMA by devising new ways of destroying their opponents. To do so, they must come to grips with fundamental changes in the social, political, and military landscapes. In some cases, they must anticipate those changes. Revolutions in military affairs require the assembly of a complex mix of tactical, organizational, doctrinal, and technological innovations in order to implement a new conceptual approach to warfare or to a specialized sub-branch of warfare. The most effective mix is rarely apparent in advance. Innovation and adaptation are messy, and even historians, with all the benefits of documentation and hindsight, find it difficult to reconstruct past events with precision. Yet in the end, battlefield outcomes usually make pitilessly clear which military organization has innovated most effectively. Revolutions in military affairs and military revolutions. In general, anticipatory RMAs of the Middle Ages and early modern era included longbows, offensive-defensive strategy, gunpowder, and new fortress architecture. Additionally, each military revolution has its own specific characteristics. Military Revolution No. 1 was the 17th century creation of the modern state and modern military institutions. Associated and resultant RMAs included 1. Dutch and Swedish tactical reforms, French tactical and organizational reforms, and Britain's financial revolution, and 2. French military reforms following the Seven Years' War. Military Revolution No. 2 and 3 were the French and Industrial Revolutions. Associated and resultant RMAs included 1. National, political, and economic mobilization, and Napoleonic warfare, that is, battlefield annihilation of the enemy's armed forces. 2. Financial and economic power based on industrialization, specifically in Britain. 3. Technological revolution in land warfare and transport, for example, telegraphs, railroads, steamships, quick-firing smokeless powder, small arms and artillery, and automatic weapons. And 4. The Fisher Revolution in naval warfare, the all-big-gun battleship and battle fleet in 1905 to 1914. Military Revolution No. 4 included the First World War, which irrevocably combined its three predecessors. Associated and resultant RMAs included combined arms tactics and operations, blitzkrieg operations, strategic bombing, carrier warfare, submarine warfare, amphibious warfare, radar and signals intelligence. Lastly, Military Revolution No. 5 included nuclear weapons and ballistic missile delivery systems. Associated and resultant RMAs included precision reconnaissance and strike, stealth, computerization and computer networking of command and control, and massively increased lethality of conventional munitions. RMAs have a number of salient characteristics. First, even in war, the most powerful accelerating force conceivable, most take considerable time to develop. 20th-century peacetime RMAs have sometimes required decades, and delays of that magnitude have inevitably led to argument over the appropriateness of the term revolutionary. Perspective also matters. To French and British officers in northern France in May 1940, the German breakthrough from the Meuse to the Channel appeared revolutionary. To the Germans, the doctrine and forces that destroyed the Allied armies in the Battle of France were an evolutionary development with a history that stretched back at least to 1917 and, in some respects, to 1807. Moreover, some German officers engaged in the fighting believed that Wehrmacht's success was due as much to political indoctrination and racist fanaticism as to tactical skill. Given that some German infantry companies attacking across the Meuse suffered upward of 70% casualties and kept fighting, it would be foolish to dismiss that view. Creating a revolution in military affairs in wartime is difficult enough, even when battle produces clear lessons paid for in blood. The combined arms RMA that emerged in the course of the First World War consisted at its core in the development of accurate indirect artillery fire in combination with decentralized infantry tactics that emphasized fire, maneuver, and exploitation. But this revolution emerged only in late 1917, after 3 years of inept slaughter. And the RMA's essence and lessons were far from clear even by 1918, as the dogged refusal of the British and French armies to come to grips with it in the ensuing 2 decades showed. Their failure and the fact that adequate analysis of the 1914-18 battlefield, with exceptions such as G.C. Wynne's brilliant If Germany Attacks, was not available until the 1980s, emphasizes the extent to which the fear, uncertainty, and confusion of war had created or exacerbated the intractable systemic problems facing Europe's armies in 1914-18. If adapting to wartime conditions is desperately difficult, those involved in peacetime innovation confront almost insoluble problems. It is here that the leaders of military institutions earn their pay. The 20th century record suggests that many have not. As a retired senior U.S. Army officer has noted, in summarizing the lessons of a series of case studies on the effectiveness of military institutions in the first half of the century, in the spheres of operations and tactics, where military competence would seem to be a nation's rightful due, the 21 case studies suggest, for the most part, less than general professional military competence, and sometimes abysmal incompetence. One can doubt whether any other profession in these 7 nations during the same periods would have received such poor ratings by similarly competent outside observers. Yet military organizations do confront immense obstacles to peacetime innovation. Michael Howard has compared their problems to those facing surgeons who must prepare to operate without the benefit of experience on live patients. Armies, navies, and air forces must be prepared to function at short notice in extraordinarily trying circumstances that by definition cannot be replicated except by killing large numbers of people. Moreover, they frequently lack the lavish financial support and staunch political backing needed for peacetime experimentation and realistic training. Yet the record, the German campaign against Western Europe in 1940, once again suggests the possibilities, shows that some have done far better than others. Discerning how and why some organizations have succeeded, and charting the nature and implications for the future of the military revolutions and RMAs of the past, is the principal purpose of the case studies that follow. Chapter 2. As if a new sun had arisen. England's 14th Century RMA, written by Clifford J. Rogers. During the reign of Edward III, 1327 to 77, England underwent a genuine and dramatic revolution in military affairs. The country's abrupt transformation from a third-rate military power into the strongest and most admired martial nation in Europe was obvious even to contemporaries. The great humanist Francesco Petrarca observed in 1360 that, "In my youth, the Britons were taken to be the meekest of the non-Italians. Today they are a fiercely bellicose nation. They have overturned the ancient military glory of the French by victories so numerous that they, who were once inferior to the wretched Scots, have reduced the entire kingdom of France by fire and sword." At about the same time, the Liegeois knight, cleric and chronicler Jean le Bel, who had served on Edward III's first campaign against the Scots in 1327 and had followed the English monarch's later military career with great interest, remarked that, "When the noble king Edward III first reconquered England in his youth in 1326, the English were generally not held in high regard, and no one spoke of their prowess or their boldness. But they have learnt skill at arms so well in the time of this noble King Edward that they are now the best fighters known." Chronicler Henry Knighton commented that in the reign of Edward's father, two Englishmen were hardly a match for one feeble Scot. A generation later, by contrast, 100 Frenchmen hardly either wished or dared to meet 20 Englishmen in the field or to give them battle. The battlefield verdicts of Edward's reign support these views. Duplin Moor, Halidon Hill, Sluys, Crecy, Neville's Cross, Poitiers, and Nájera constitute a roll of honour equalled by no other English monarch in history. Indeed, no other European nation achieved a comparable string of battlefield successes between the fall of Rome and the French Revolution and Empire. Edward's list compares well even with the victories of Napoleon, for English forces overcame heavy numerical odds in all of their fights. Conservative estimates are 10-1, yes, 10-1 at Duplin Moor, 2-1 at Halidon Hill, 2-1 at Crecy, 1.9-1 at Neville's Cross, 2.3-1 at Poitiers, and 1.5-1 at Nájera. The figures are all the more remarkable when we consider that Clausewitz, writing in the mid-19th century, was able to find only two examples in all modern history of a defeat of a larger European army by one half its size. These battles, moreover, were not merely defeats for Edward's enemies, they were all crushing defeats. At Duplin Moor, 1,500 Englishmen defeated 15,000 Scots, killed the Regent of Scotland and four of the five Scottish earls present, captured the fifth, and killed about 3,000 Scots. Cases in which an army has killed twice its own numbers in enemies against a technologically comparable opponent on an open battlefield are rare indeed. Subsequently, at Halidon Hill, the English killed the new Regent of Scotland, another four earls, and more thousands of Scots. At Sluys, more Frenchmen perished than at Agincourt, or Waterloo, or Dien Bien Phu. Edward's outnumbered fleet won the largest naval battle of his century, even more decisively than Napoleon's fleet lost Trafalgar. According to the king himself, the English captured 166 of 190 French ships, whereas Nelson's fleet at Trafalgar captured only 18 of the 33 French and Spanish ships, while 11 escaped to Cadiz. At Crecy, England thoroughly smashed the French royal army. The King of Bohemia, 1,500 other nobles, and numberless infantrymen lay dead on the field. Among those who fled were the King of France, wounded by multiple arrows, the King of Majorca, and a future Holy Roman Emperor. At Neville's Cross, the English captured the King of Scots. At Poitiers, King John II of France suffered the same fate at the hands of the Black Prince, Edward's eldest son. And Edward never met his Waterloo, nor Leipzig, nor Borodino. England won all its major land battles during his 50-year reign. These tactical triumphs led to political settlements that were highly impressive, if far from enduring. Scotland twice fell under English domination in 1333 and 1335, and would have stayed there, as even the Scots admitted, had not the struggle with a greater foe, France, distracted Edward. In that great contest, English arms won a remarkable triumph with the 1360 Treaty of Bretigny, by which the Valois agreed to surrender a full third of France to English sovereign rule. Further south, the Black Prince's intervention in Iberia temporarily restored the English-sponsored Pedro the Cruel to the throne of Castile, and Edward III's martial successes so impressed European opinion that the English king was offered the crown of the Holy Roman Empire as the most worthy, most vigorous, most powerful knight of Christendom. Things had clearly changed since the days of Edward II, always lily-livered and luckless in war. Indeed, wrote the chronicler Thomas Walsingham, it seemed to the English almost as if a new sun had arisen because of the glory of their victories. Medieval historians have recently begun to examine this remarkable transformation in war-making ability from the perspective of the early modern military revolution thesis, either within a purely British context as part of an Edwardian military revolution, or along with the accomplishments of Flemings, Swiss, Scots, and others as part of the infantry revolution of the early 14th century. This essay will take it as given that England did undergo a 14th century revolution in military affairs, and will re-examine Edward's wars to see what they can tell us about the relationship linking technology, organization, tactics, strategy, and individual leadership within an RMA. Technology. Commentators often view RMAs as driven above all by technology. But with the proviso that the development from innovation to revolution requires organizational and doctrinal adaptation before the tactical and strategic potential of new weapon systems can be realized, the formulation of Andrew Krepinovich is typical. Military revolutions comprise four elements: technological change, systems development, operational innovation, and organizational adaptation. Each of these elements is in itself a necessary but not a sufficient condition for realizing the large gains in military effectiveness that characterize military revolutions. The obvious technological component of the English 14th century RMA is the famous yew longbow, a weapon basically similar to the wooden self-bows in use since the Neolithic age, but longer, with a heavier draw weight and so more power than earlier weapons. Although one historian has recently challenged the traditional view of the weapon's killing power, a careful examination of the contemporary sources reaffirms the conclusion that the 14th century longbow was lethal even against armored troops. In the hands of a strong and skilled archer, it could fire at least three times as fast as a contemporary composite-bowed crossbow, could shoot further and beyond point-blank distance with much greater accuracy, and could strike with enough impact to penetrate armor and inflict serious or even lethal wounds on men or horses. Many contemporary sources attest its importance for Edward III's victories. Take, for example, his first battle at Halidon Hill in 1333. The chroniclers describe the English archers as having inflicted a tremendous massacre on the Scots and as striking them down by the thousands. Yet by 1333, the longbow was scarcely a new technology. It had been a principal weapon of the English monarchy's armed forces for half a century. Of the English force that Robert the Bruce's Scots crushed at Bannockburn in 1314, the longbowmen probably formed the majority. For all their fine qualities, Edward II's archers failed to prevent one of the worst humiliations inflicted upon an English army between Hastings and the fall of Singapore, even though the army in question was perhaps the largest and best-equipped expeditionary force that an English monarch had assembled up to that point, and far outnumbered its Scottish opponents. Edward II, for all his longbowmen, clearly did not benefit from an RMA, and so, equally clearly, the adoption of the longbow had not produced one. Finding a technological cause for the radical transformation of English military effectiveness under Edward III requires a search for changes in the Plantagenet army's military equipment, which developed specifically in the years between Scottish victory at Bannockburn in 1314 and Scottish defeat at Duplin Moor in 1332. Two such changes stand out: the introduction of gunpowder weapons and the dramatic improvement in the armour and war horses of the English men-at-arms. Edward III's first campaign in 1327 was the first in Europe in which gunpowder weapons are recorded as having been used, and the king remained on the cutting edge of artillery technology for most of his career. The cannon his troops fired at Crecy may have been the first ever used in a field battle, and his provision of 10 guns, including 2 Grossa, for the siege of Calais in 1346-47 was impressive for its day. Equally striking to contemporaries was the dramatic improvement in English men-at-arms armour and equipment. At the time of Bannockburn, most English knights relied on mail armour and pothelms for protection. Documents describing equipment forfeited after the Battle of Boroughbridge in 1322 show that by then a well-equipped knight might well have had some plate protection, but the testimony of Jean Le Bel indicates that as late as 1327, most English men-at-arms still wore neither plate armour nor bassinets, but only mail hauberks and old-fashioned great helms. The example of the Hainaulter knights who came to England to serve Edward in 1326 and 1327, and the demands of his frequent campaigns, reinforced by the king's own example of extravagant spending on war horses and military equipment, quickly brought England's chivalry up to continental standards. Indeed, for the next century, English cavaliers were among the best armed in Europe. Comparison between the funeral brass of the English knight Sir Robert de Bures circa 1331 and the illumination of a knight in the Walter de Milmet manuscript of 1326 on the one hand, and the brass of Sir John Dabernon circa 1340 on the other, illustrates the difference. The first two show men clad in mail armour with little or no plate reinforcement. Dabernon, by contrast, has almost his entire body protected by plate as well as mail, including torso and groin, which are covered by a coat of plates, the external rivets of which are visible beneath the front of his surcoat. During this period, English knights and esquires also appear to have improved substantially the quality of their battle horses, as indicated by the greatly increased average and maximum prices found in the Resta rolls, the records kept so that the government could fairly compensate men-at-arms for horses killed in service. Andrew Ayton, the leading expert on the subject, has described this development as an Edwardian horse-breeding revolution. From the standpoint of a study of revolutions in military affairs, however, the most interesting thing about these impressive improvements in arms and equipment is that they made little difference on the battlefield. An important warning against the assumption that correlation equates to causation. Doubtless their improved armour benefited English men-at-arms as they withstood the shock of a French charge. The idea that dismounted heavy cavalry were helpless lobsters is a myth, but it was far from decisive. Swiss halberdiers and pikemen of the same era, although lightly armoured, proved equally effective at the same task. Although the improvements in English men-at-arms equipment after 1327 did keep them from being at a major disadvantage when fighting French knights and esquires at Crecy and Poitiers, they did not make any positive contribution to the English victories there, for the French had also adopted plate armour. Conversely, Edward II's men-at-arms had already possessed a significant advantage in armour over the even worse-equipped Scots, but this had not helped at Bannockburn. A 15-pound charger might have radically greater impact on an equestrian's aesthetic sense than a 10-pound warhorse, but the battlefield effect was less significant, especially since English men-at-arms, almost without exception, mounted only for pursuit after winning the battle. As for the cannon, the chronicler who records their first use in 1327 describes them as novelties that apparently made an impression mainly because of the noise they produced. He calls them crackies of war. His account gives no indication they were of military importance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.